Good morning. Yes, you are correct. I am not Pastor Charlie, and quite honestly, I'm very glad that you noticed that. I'm Shirley Geisler, and I get the privilege of welcoming you this morning, and I really do mean that. It's a privilege to welcome you. I miss you. I wish that you were in front of me right now and not the camera, but this is the way it is, and I'm thankful that we have this. So, welcome to our service this morning. As Pastor Charlie mentioned at the end of last week's service, he and Karen are away celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary, and that is a huge accomplishment. And I know that you're happy along with me and that they're having this chance to get away. These times have been challenging for all of us. And as a pastor and pastor's wife, they carry a lot of that because that's who they are. They're shepherds and they care for us. And so the fact that they can get away for a weekend, not just to celebrate their anniversary, which is huge, but just to get away and be together, to allow God's spirit to minister to them in his beautiful creation. Hopefully they're seeing some beautiful sunsets that warm their souls, and that they are having a chance to listen to the waves, the power and yet the calmness of the waves that God has created. I pray all of that will just minister to them in some wonderful ways this weekend. And one thing that we know is that wherever they are walking with God. He tells us that every week to walk with God, and we know that both of them do. And so we know that. We also know that wherever they are right now, they are thinking of us, and they are worshiping with us in spirit and in truth. So in just a moment, I'm going to lead just an opening prayer. And then when we're finished praying and I'll introduce the song, we'll be joined by Pastor Sladen Yarbrough. And many of us remember Pastor Sladen. He was our interim pastor for a little over 11 months, starting in January 2017. He came to us and brought great leadership, joy, humor is important, creativity. He's a very creative person in creating a service and a message. And, of course, great biblical truth that he brought to us, as well as a wonderful understanding of Baptist history, which is his forte. When he comes to us later, he's going to tell us a little bit about what he and Janice have been doing during this time since they've been away. And he will lead us in a message on what it means to be a church during COVID-19 times. So I know that that is going to be very good and interesting. I just am happy that he's with us this morning. He's a wonderful pastor and leader, and we will be blessed by what he has to share with us. So let's just have a short opening prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, that you walk with us through our joys and our challenges that come to us. And so that's a wonderful promise that you have given to us, that you're with us. And so I thank you for that. I pray for our pastor today as he is away with Karen and hopefully getting, as we were saying earlier, that much needed time in your creation to restore and refresh them for further ministry here. So we pray for the two of them, and we thank you that you brought them to us at this time when they would walk with us through these times. So thank you, Lord. And again, we thank you for Pastor Sladen and for the message that you have laid on his heart to bring to us today. We know, Lord, that you will bless us as he blesses us through your word. So thank you. And God, just again, we thank you for this time to be together. And we pray that you will continue to teach us through the words of song and through the words that Pastor Sladen shares with us as we continue on in worship. We love you. We are so thankful for you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our song this morning is a medley of three songs. It's called Standing on the Promises, and of course that's the lead song, but there's two other songs kind of woven in there. See if you can catch those as we sing. But the main point of it is that we stand on God's promises, and he's given us a lot of promises. I looked in the Bible to see what exactly I would say to you about the promises of God. And quite honestly, there's a lot. I encourage you to open up your Bibles, to do a Google search on the promises of God and in the Bible, and see what God has to say to us that are wonderful truths to guide us. So as I was thinking about that, I found just a few to share with you this morning, and I'm going to read them to you, but I'm going to read them instead of personal, about to me, God is with me. I'm going to say God is with us, and it's going to be hopefully an encouragement to you. So God is with us. He will strengthen us and help us. The Lord will never leave us, and he will never forsake us. He will counsel us and keep his loving eye upon us. God will give us his peace, which transcends all understanding. And whoa, do we need that right now? There's so much going on in our world and in our country that we just cannot possibly understand. But thank God, thank our God, that he does understand. There's nothing that we're walking through that he isn't walking through with us. And that in itself is a wonderful promise. So let's sing now the song, Standing on His Promises.
Greetings. It's so good to be back with you again here at First Baptist Church, even though we're doing this virtually. That's the reality that we live with in this day and time. But I just want to say that my time here as your interim has been one of the most positive and rewarding experiences since Janice and I have been out in the Northwest. We truly enjoyed the time, appreciated the people, and I learned a lot. I always learn a lot when I go into an interim situation. So I'm just really glad to be back, and I hope that before too long, we also can get back together in a worship service as we gather as God's people. Just a few updates. What's been going on in my life since I left as interim? I almost immediately went from First Baptist Church, Gresham, to First Baptist Church, Oregon City, and I was there for 14 months. It was a historic church, which those of you who remember me, I love the Baptist history, and there's so much of it in that congregation. Basically, since that time, I filled in a number of churches as supply preacher, and in terms of the COVID-19 and the stay in place, Janice and I have been kind of busy reading books and reading magazines, what they call binge watching some series on Netflix. We also have worked over 40 1,000 piece jigsaw puzzles. I think that's good for the mind. We've tried. And I also have gotten to do some writing. I had a couple projects I wanted to do, which I probably would not have done if the virus had not come along. But I have written a book, which is a summary, or actually an inclusion of 6 of my monologue sermons and 3 of my dramatic readings. And one of the dramatic readings is called I Am Christmas. We did that here, and probably 10 to 12 people, maybe more, participated in that. So I put these together in a collection, and it should be ready to go in paperback in about the next month or so, and it'll also be in an e-publication. So that was pretty exciting. And then I updated a book that I'd written on Southern Baptists, and you may remember Mike Kuykendall. Mike has preached here. He also has, I think, taught here, and he helped me by bringing the book up to date for the last 20 years. I originally published it in 2000. So that's what we've been doing along the way, and I'm delighted again to be here this morning. Let's begin this morning with an opening prayer, a pastoral prayer, and I have written this out. You can bow your heads and listen if you choose to do so, but I tried to spend some time thinking, what do I really want to say to God and for you and for me at this time? Let us pray together. Our God, as we gather on this day, not in sanctuary, but in spirit, we invoke your presence wherever we may be, especially in a time such as this. We are before you because of your grace and forgiveness. On this day, as we consider that we are the church of your Son, increase our awareness that wherever we are, you are there also. And may our words and our lives proclaim the good news that is ours and which is announced for all. For those in our congregation and those whom we encounter who are troubled, who are distressed, who feel alone, who face problems with help, with family, with work, or the lack thereof, or who are simply tired because of all that is going on, we lift them up to you. Inspire in us a willingness to convey to them that we care for them, that we pray for them, and that we love them as you love us. We especially lift up those whose lives have been disrupted by the fires in our state and our neighboring states, for those who have struggled with recent flooding, and for those who have had to face the consequences of COVID-19, we lift all of them up to you. Comfort those who have lost loved ones. Give hope to those who have lost houses and possessions. And lead us to find ways to support and help them in prayer, in service, and even in our resources. We offer this prayer in the name of our Lord Jesus, your word that became flesh and dwells now among us, full of grace and truth. Amen. This morning, I want to speak to you on a subject which I think is kind of relevant. It's called the church in a COVID-19 pandemic age. A few months ago, my pastor, Jeremy Richards, asked me to fill in for him while he was taking some vacation time. And so in August, I filled in. And Jeremy had been preaching a series of sermons on that word may not be what you think it means. And so he assigned me the word church. He said, it's because you have such an interest in Baptist history and Baptist churches. And I think it was a good choice because it's something I really wanted to do and I had been doing some thinking about. So today we're going to talk about the church and try to, in the end, pull it together and relate it and its teachings for us here in this pandemic age in which we find ourselves. I'm going to read three passages of Scripture. And as you listen to these, listen for the concept of the word church or churches in the plural. The first is a familiar passage out of Matthew 16, verses 13 through 19. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And then in Galatians, the first three verses of chapter 1, "Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through men, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me, to the churches of Galatia." Ephesians 3, verses 10 through 11, "His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord." May the word be blessed in our lives, in Jesus' name. Here's my outline for today. After a few introductory comments, I want to jump right in and I want to talk about the term in the Greek language, ecclesia, the term which we translate as church. And I want to spend just a few moments talking about definitions and translations, because I think it's very important for us to understand this process and maybe some changes in the translations that we ought to think about for our understanding of what it means to be the church here in the 21st century. And then I want to talk about the church in a local or general sense. Is the church local, a particular congregation, or is there a general church? And I want to talk about what the Bible has to say about that. And also the Baptist heritage, which is really important in shaping how we approach the concept of the church today and how that relates to our efforts and attempts to be relevant in this world in which we find ourselves even now. And then finally, I want to talk about the church gathered and the church dispersed. Gathered is a language which I think we probably can all understand because we've done that. But we don't talk much about the church dispersed. We maybe use other terms in that particular regard. But I think it's a good term for the situation in which we find ourselves right now. And there's some teaching in that for us and some learning in light of our experience that we are going through in this very time. Let's begin by talking about how we got the word church. And we go back to the Greek language. The Greek language was so important to the early church because it was the universal language of the Roman Empire. And those early believers who went out into that empire and shared and proclaimed the good news of Jesus, they were able to do so because they could do so in a common language of the people. It really paved the way for the advancement of the church, moving from being just a sect of Judaism to becoming really a church with universal claims. And the early writings that we have, the New Testament, used the Greek language. Now, I think Arminian was probably the common language among the people in Palestine. But they used the Greek language in their writings. And the word that we translate church is the word ecclesia. This word comes from two terms, ek and kaleo. Ek means from, kaleko, to call out. And so the term really is saying to us in the English, to call out from. As I thought about this sermon, and as I put it together, it kind of came to me that, you know, really, we might misunderstand being called out from. We often think in terms we're separated from the world, but it doesn't mean we're isolated from the world. And I thought of some other teachings of Jesus. One, he says that he was praying for them not to be in the world, not to be of the world, but to be in the world. And then I thought about the Sermon on the Mount. And when Jesus tried to explain who we are as citizens of his kingdom, he used metaphors. We are salt, you know, we are kind of a preservative, or we are ones who give flavor to this world in which we live. We are light, we're the light of the world, and in the darkness that we find out there, when you turn the light on, the darkness disappears, and we have that task. We're like a city that's set on a hill for everyone to see, and that's a very important metaphor for us. And in other places, he talks about the fact that we are like leaven. You know, we're there in the world, and we seem almost insignificant, but suddenly when that bread begins to rise, we see the influence that we have. And so when I look at this, as we understand ecclesia to be called out from, it doesn't mean isolated or separated, but rather, I think, to be one of these metaphors in this world in which we live. Let me talk about translations. On one side of it, as we look back, ecclesia was used to translate a Hebrew term, kahal. And kahal was a term used many times in the Hebrew Bible, or what we call the Old Testament. It was used many times to describe the people gathered together for something important. For example, when Moses comes back from Mount Sinai and with the law, the people gather together at the base there. And they gather as kahal. They are a gathered people. We go to the New Testament, being written in Greek, and the term ecclesia is there. But as the church began to expand, even though there was a common language of Greek, it also needed to be translated into many other languages wherever the church was. And that was the task of going from the other side of ecclesia, translating that into the common language or the vernacular of many people. In Western Christianity, which centered around Rome and out of which the Roman Catholic Church arose, the Latin was the official language. It was the official language of the Roman Empire. A lot of the terms that we have in law today, like habeas corpus, are terms that we're common with. They came out of the official legal language of the Roman Empire. And when it came time to translate the scriptures, including the New Testament, into Latin, the word that was chosen was kuriakon. And kuriakon refers to a place, a sacred place, a holy place, a building or an altar. And that word was used to translate ecclesia. As the Protestant Reformation came along, of course, one of the major emphases was the importance of the scriptures for the people and putting the scriptures into the language of the people. Martin Luther translated the New Testament and then after that the Old Testament into German, and the word chosen was Kirche, and I cannot get that guttural sound that comes from the R's in the German language. And in Scotland it was Kirk, and in English it was church. And all of these terms really applied to places where the church met, where the ecclesia met. And we become accustomed to using that term, and I think often being shaped by that idea or that term. The early translations were from the Latin Vulgate, and therefore the idea of kuriakon coming out of that carries over into the understanding of the church. I think also the church became a term used for an institution, for what is being done in these buildings. And we have worship, we have committee meetings, we have officers of the church, like the pastor, the priest, the deacons, and other organizations within the church. And so the church took on a strong institutional sense in terms of its definition. That, I think, has affected us today. We talk about the church. Someone asks you, hey, are you a member of a church? Yes, I'm a member of First Baptist. Well, tell me about it. Well, we are located down on the corner of Powell and Walter Street or some other location where we might find ourselves. and we go there to do church. We go to church to worship. We pray, we sing, we have the scriptures read, we expositate upon the scriptures, we do the most important of Baptist things, we take an offering. At this point in the worship service, I would pause with the people and let them catch up and try to laugh at that. I hope it, but I don't know if that carries through in a recording like this. But we do things that are churchly things, and we sometimes identify them with the church itself. We have business meetings, and we have found that we've had to do some adjustments in relationship to that. Here in the age of the virus, we have teaching sessions like our Sunday school. We have fellowship, which is one of the things that I miss most right now during this time in which we live. So understanding the word ecclesia, I think, is important because we need to realize that without knowing it, sometimes we have replaced in translation a word that refers to people with words that refer to places and institutions. And one of the lessons that we can, and I think are learning again in this time, is to go back and emphasize the church really is the people, and the original meaning of ecclesia points us in that direction. A second aspect of the church has to do with, is the church local or is the church general or universal? And I want to say a few words about what the Bible has to say and also the kind of the heritage within Baptists, because this has really shaped who we are. And I think it's important in terms of understanding who we are here in the 21st century. In the New Testament, the word ecclesia is found over 100 times. I've seen 112, 115, 116. I'm not sure what these scholars are looking at and how they can come up with different numbers, but over 100 times. In most cases, the word church is used in a local sense. Paul's letters are a good example of this. He writes to the church at Thessalonica, at Rome, at Corinth, at Philippi. He refers these to each church that he's writing to, and each church is an independent and autonomous local church under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Also, you look at the book of Revelation, and as John writes, he describes seven churches that are there in chapters 2 and 3. I don't know if I can remember all of these, but the church of Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Sardis, Thyatira, Laodicea, and Philadelphia. And each one of these is a local and independent church. But I read the scripture in the opening of the book of Galatians. And that church, or that book, is written to the churches of Galatia. Again, you have the idea of local churches and congregations. On the other hand, we sometimes think of the church in a general sense. And the passage in Ephesians really seems to be referring to the church and its duties and responsibilities in a general sense. And in our day and time, we often hear the term church. If people want to criticize what's going on religiously, they'll talk about the church needs to be doing this, the church needs to be doing that, the church shouldn't be doing this or that. And we use it in a general sense. We talk about the influence of the church in the 21st century. We talk about the responsibilities or the mission and the ministry of the church in the 21st century. And I think what I'm saying here in terms of the Bible, you can use it either way. And we do use it either way. Now let's shift gears and talk about Baptists. And most of you come out of a Baptist background, but some do not. But I think it's important for all of us to reaffirm what it means to be the church in the Baptist heritage and tradition. We have a strong emphasis upon the local church. And I can trace this back to the time when Baptists in the United States split into North and South. It came about because of the issue of slavery, and Baptists, not all, but most Baptists had organized into societies for foreign missions, for home missions, for publications, and we were united. But the issue of slavery came along, and the debate really began, can people who are slave owners be appointed as missionaries? And you know which way the North went, you know which way the South went. And we split In May of 1845, Southern Baptists separated and formed what is known as the Southern Baptist Convention, and the Baptists in the North continued to operate these respective and independent societies. Out of this came a controversy about the local church or the church in general. A man by the name of J.R. Graves, James Robinson Graves, was pastor of First Baptist Church in Nashville, Tennessee. And he was a strong emphasis upon the local church. The light has just gone out. The darkness is not quite upon us, however. But he had a strong, strong emphasis on the local church. And what really upset him is what happened at the beginning of the Southern Baptist Convention. In the preface to their constitution, or in the preamble to their constitution, they stated that basically the convention, as it was being organized, had the right to establish as many boards as necessary for propagating the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they also established two boards, a foreign mission board and a home mission board. And Graves didn't like that. He said, you cannot have these independent organizations sending out missionaries or supporting missionaries. That's the right and the responsibility of a local church. And so he really focused upon the local church. The movement that he organized became known as landmarkism. There's a couple passages in Psalms that says, do not remove the ancient landmarks, the ancient boundaries, you know, of the property. And then somewhere else shortly after that, some removed the ancient landmarks. And he's saying, we are removing these ancient landmarks, the right and the responsibility of doing missions and ministry belongs to the local church. Only a local church can call and send out a missionary. Only a local church can provide the resources. And if necessary, only a local church can discipline those missionaries. Only a local church can do the ordinances. It's not something that a convention of churches can do. And so there was a strong movement, and it affected Baptist life for many years, including Baptists not only in the South, but Baptists in the North. And it shaped our understanding, at least in some positive ways, as well as, I think, negative. But it shaped our understanding of the importance of a local church being under the lordship of Christ, who is the head of that local church, and that local church is a full and complete independent church. They even got to the point of saying that some of these other organizations who are not Baptists are not even churches, they're religious societies. But this strong emphasis was one that I was raised in. My pastor had a strong landmarkist emphasis in him. And I think we tried to do good work. At the same time, Baptists throughout their history have found that we can work together. And we formed what is called associations, and there are probably some other terms, but I like the associational term. And coming together, we can do things that we could not do very well independently. Missions, ministries, education, publications, all of these were really quite important in the process. Very early on in England, some of the churches began to produce confessional statements to say to the world, here's what we really do believe. And in the preface of many of these statements, it was clearly pointed out that these were independent representatives of independent local congregations who have agreed to come together and agreed upon these statements. In October 2nd, 1792, the Baptists in Britain, for the very first time, organized a mission society to take the gospel to the whole world. It was the Baptist Missionary Society, and that was the beginning of the modern mission movement that caught on in the United States. And in 1814, we formed our first national organization for the cause of missions and ministry. Now, initially, we focused on several different missions, but very soon after that, the organization focused on foreign missions only. I think the name of that was the General Missionary Convention of the Baptist Denomination of the United States, or in the United States, for foreign missions, a very long title. Someone said, why don't we call it the Triennial Convention because we meet every 3 years? That person is an unnamed hero, I think, because of that. You couldn't get all of that on a business card. Secondly, we formed an organization to publish Sunday school literature and books, the American Baptist Publication Society. That was in 1826, and in 1834, we formed the Home Mission, the American Baptist Home Mission Society. And the work that we do out here was a result of the work of that Home Mission Society. Very early on, in the 1840s, we sent out missionaries, a fellow by the name of Ezra Fisher and his family, and Hezekiah Smith. And Hezekiah Smith formed First Baptist Church of Oregon City. So we did a lot together we could not do separately. And I think that we continue to do that today. The American Baptists, you know, stayed with it beginning in 1814. In 1907, we took on the convention approach to pull things together to make it a little simpler. In 1950, we changed the name to the American Baptist Convention. I came out of the Southern Baptist movement. A lot of Southern Baptists I talked to, old-timers, they didn't like that because the American Baptists jumped the gun and got the really good name that was available out there. And then in 1972, and I think this is very instructive, we changed the name to the American Baptist Churches of the USA, of the United States of America, because we wanted to emphasize the importance of all the local congregations who were uniting together in this organization to do mission and to do ministry. And our regions did the same thing. When Janice and I moved out here, it was the American Baptist Churches of Oregon, with one exception over in Camas. We had a church in Washington. And then we had a group that got disgruntled with another group down in California, and over 50 of their churches, I think, joined us, so we changed the name again to the American Baptist Churches of the Central Pacific Coast. Here's what's important about that. It is the local church that is the heart and soul of our organizations as American Baptists. It is the local church, I think, that sets the tone and direction. And we are different from one another. I have been so fortunate to serve as interim or supply preacher in a number of the American Baptist churches out here. You are not clones of one another. You are not the same. And yet we all pull together in common causes and work together. The region is not an authoritative organization that dictates to a local congregation. We voluntarily join together. We voluntarily work and serve with each other, and we respect one another, and we figure out ways to get along sometimes, even when there is tension in the process. And it's good because our churches can remain healthy, and we can go out and figure out what's going on in our communities and shape and mold who we are to best respond in mission and service in that process. Let me say one other thing. You sometimes hear someone talk about the American Baptist Church. There is no American Baptist Church in a denominational sense. There is only a local American Baptist Church. But we come together as churches to form these organizations. So if someone says, hey, are you a member of the American Baptist Church? You can say, I'm a member of an American Baptist Church, an American Baptist Church in the process. That brings us today, and I want to talk about gathered and dispersed. And when I mention gathered, we are familiar with this. All of us who are Christians and Baptists, members, a part of a church, we've been in an environment of a gathered church. We come together to worship. We come together to sing and to pray and to hear the word proclaimed. We come together as a people, and it's been such an important part of all of our lives that the changes that have come along really have been disturbing, at least initially. We come together to do business sometimes, or to have programs, or to have music. One of the things Janice and I really love about First Baptist Church of Gresham is the music programs, and we were disappointed we didn't get to come to the Christmas program this year. And so we look at the things that we do collectively. We gather together. We have the fellowships which we have. And suddenly that all changed at the beginning of this year with the COVID-19 crisis and the stay in place policies that came along. And these are important as we seek to, I think, do common sense and respond to this very tragic and challenging circumstance in which we find ourselves. But as I looked at this and I thought about this, there was a word that I borrowed from Judaism in the first century. There were Palestinian Jews, And then there were the Jews of dispersion, those outside Palestine. If my memory is correct from my teaching days, it seemed like it was estimated there may have been about 600,000 Jews in Palestine, and maybe 3.5 to 4 million Jews dispersed throughout the Roman Empire. And so I borrowed that term dispersal because I think that's where we are today. We may not get together right now as we are so accustomed to, but the church continues on. And we have figured out new ways to do the things that we have done as a church and even come up, I think, with some new ideas in the process. I think the virus, as critical and challenging as it's been, is healthy for us. It has helped us to go back and think anew what we do and why we do the things that we do. We may not gather together in this place on Sunday morning, but we still can gather in spirit as the people of God, and we wind up doing this virtually. You know, we record the worship service, and some are doing Zoom. My church has started out doing recordings, and now we're doing Zooming, and it's kind of strange this weekend. I'm able to preach in two places at one time because I'm recording this, and I got a call from Karen Woods just a few days ago. Can you fill in for the next two Sundays? And so as I speak to you, if you're following this service on Sunday, later in the afternoon at 4 o'clock, I'm going to do Zoom worship with them, and I'm going to do my reflections from actually my bedroom, putting my computer on the bed in a nice business chair by my computer stand. So we figured out new ways to do things. You can look at Zoom and you can see the pictures of all the people who are there participating in that. It's not the best in some ways, but in other ways, we are not to be deterred. We are going to worship God collectively in spirit, if not in place. We do other things. We do business. Our church has decided that after the death of George Floyd, that we wanted to help the black organizations in our area. We had a business meeting. We put forth 5 different organizations, and we voted to support 2 of them and one organization in our church, and we wound up taking $7,000. And we're not a rich church at all. We're a small church, and dividing it equally among 3 organizations. And we debated that, and we voted coming out of that on 2 of the 5 organizations we were looking at. And then we voted on that, and I think the vote was something like 27-1. We had one person that didn't want us to do this. That's the Baptist way, you know. And we didn't try to find out who that person was and throw them out. We respected their differences in that. And we found a new way to serve and minister because of this virus. And we did it all with Zoom. And then we had our vote by the internet. You know, we live in such a great time. If you're going to have a pandemic, we live in a great time for communicating and working with one another. We have found ways to associate. I asked Shirley about, what are you doing that's different? And the drive by and say hi a program, you know, and you even do ministry in that by collecting canned goods for service, if I understand that correctly. I even think that maybe I heard you did ice cream at one time. And why didn't you call me? Janice would have been in the car ready to go honking the horn. You know, we love ice cream. But we find new ways to do things. Some have found ways to respond to the virus. Janice made over 50 of these. She is fantastic with the sewing machine, I'm telling you. And she distributed these to family and friends and church members who didn't have access to them. And I'm sure that many of you have done the same thing or something similar to that. But we find new ways to minister. It has been enlightening. You know what I think of when I think of this? I think of the early church. And there they were. Right after Jesus had given the instructions to be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and Gresham and to the ends of the earth. And then Jesus arose, he disappeared, you know, at least as far as the presence here in the ascension. And he said he promised the Spirit, and there they were. And what did they have? They didn't have a church building. They didn't have a constitution and bylaws. They just had a mandate to go and be witnesses. And lo and behold, the Spirit showed up and people began to respond. And what really surprised them, I think, is that people that they didn't expect to respond started responding. Samaritans. They didn't get along very well with the mainstream Jews of that time, but the word was they were responding. And they sent out representatives, and the Spirit approved. And they found that there was a guy by the name of Cornelius, a Roman centurion, who was what was called a God-fearer because he was really interested in Judaism. But he heard about Jesus and he sought out Peter, and Peter was uncomfortable, but he went, and the next thing you know, the gospel moved further. And when Paul was preaching, they would go into the synagogues and preach about Jesus. This was a sect of Judaism. But Paul began to discover that there were Gentiles who were interested, and he began to go to them directly. And we became a universal religion. And what I'm saying is, if we look for the presence of the Spirit, can guide us and direct us in this world, and we were going to come out of this better off than we did, than we were as we went into it. And I really and truly believe that. So we need to think about, yes, the church gathered, and we look forward to that time when we can do it again, but we are the church dispersed. Wherever we are, the ecclesia, the people of God, the followers of Jesus are there. And let me conclude with one point. I read this and I should have recorded where I stole it from, but there's someone out there that in an article made a statement that I think makes the most sense in the world. And it's this, that the gospel cannot be quarantined. We just can't do that. We are the church of Jesus in the 21st century in an age of COVID-19, and we are going to get the job done. We're going to sing a hymn now. And it's an old one. It's called The Church is One Foundation. You will remember this, no doubt. You may want to sing along or hum along. And Shirley has put together some slides. And in a sense, they're buildings. And that almost sounds contradictory to what I said. But if you look at those buildings, they're all so different. They're so wonderful, to the cathedrals on one hand and to the little frame church out in the country on the other. And it's in those buildings that we, the church, have gathered through the ages, through the years, through the centuries. And it is in those buildings that you find this diversity of people. And when those doors open, out we go. I don't know if I can remember the little thing, you know, this is the church, this is the steeple, look inside and see the people, you know, something like that. I never was very good at that. But when those doors open, we're in the world. And right now our doors are closed, but we're still out there. And we are the people who have the message of the good news to share. We are the church of the dispersion in the 21st century. Let us sing.
Good morning. I'm Brenda Del Martyr, sitting in our church sanctuary, and I'm so excited for the possibility, hopefully in the near future, that we can be all together. That's going to be a glorious day. I just have some announcements I would like to share with you this morning. First of all, those prayer requests, keep sending those in to prayer@fbcgo.org. Those go right to our prayer team, and it's just such a wonderful ministry in our church. Second of all, I wanted to reaffirm that giving is good. Thank you. And as a member of stewardship ministry, I am just so impressed that even during this time when we can't be together physically, that the giving is still there. And just remember, you can do this in a couple of different ways. You can mail it, or you can come by, go through the church parking lot, and just drop it off in the church mail slot. Thank you, and thank you again. The third announcement is a really special one. This Wednesday, September 23rd, is the parking lot event, barring any weather changes, and I'll get to that in just a minute. Now, it begins at 5:30. So in order for this service to begin promptly, you want to remember to arrive early to the parking lot, drop off your food donations, and walk to the church parking lot with your chair. And if you need any assistance when you first arrive, there'll be some parking lot attendants to help you. Now, there's some critical details to know to make this work successfully. First of all, when you arrive at our church, you need to park at either West Gresham Grade School or the city parking lot only. Then bring your own chairs to sit in our parking lot 6 feet apart. And again, there'll be some parking lot attendants to help you do that. We want to maintain that social distancing. If you do not have a chair, don't worry. We've got chairs available for you. Bring your own mask. But again, if you don't have a mask, there'll be some extras for you as well. The third thing that you need to remember is if you have any snow cap, food, or toiletry donations, all you need to do is look for Jack Bilderback's pickup. He will be parked near the city parking lot, and he'll have a lot of snow cap signs plastered on his pickup. All you have to do is bring your items there. There'll be our stewardship team there ready to receive your goods with their gloves and masks on. Now, remember, this last week there was a donation list sent out via email. And besides the typical donated items, you would want to consider some important things that they really need, like baby formula and baby food, bottles of hand sanitizers, toilet paper, paper towels, baby wipes, and diapers. Those are of special importance. And remember, these items go to families in the East County who are going through some hard times because of the pandemic and loss of jobs. So your donations are greatly appreciated. The next thing you need to remember about Wednesday night is the fact that dinner will be served, so you do not have to cook that night. There'll be hot dogs, condiments, chips, cookies, and bottled water. They'll be served from a red wagon and a blue wagon pulled by our lovely Marty Piper and Jackie Cecil. You know, if this comes off Wednesday night, it's going to be a wonderful time of singing, sharing, and devotions led by Charlie. I hope you can make it. But we know this is Oregon. We know that things can change, and it looks like that might be the case. So watch your email just in case we need to cancel this event. We hope it doesn't happen, but check your email. And if you don't have email, call somebody, call a friend, and find out, those people that do have email, to find out if this event is still going on or if it's been canceled. And finally, the last announcement is that we have a church reopening target date of Sunday, October 11th. That date could change. We don't know for sure. So just simply watch your email. Again, call that friend who has email to find out any updates, and we will get more information out to you in the near future. So now I would like you to sit back and enjoy a flashback video showing a work party at Pastor Charlie and Karen's house 1 year ago to spruce up their yard. I have to say, it was truly a labor of love. Enjoy, take care, God bless.
Just whistle while you work, and cheerfully together we can tidy up the place. So I'm a merry tune.
I want to close this morning with a benediction which I have borrowed and one which you may be familiar with. From Reinhold Niebuhr, it's called the Serenity Prayer, and I think it's appropriate for our time. God, grant us a serenity to accept the things we cannot change, courage to change the things we can, and wisdom to know the difference. Amen.